My name is Dan Hartl. I studied genetics for my PhD at the University of Wisconsin, and then did a postdoctoral research at the University of California, Berkeley. And I've been on the faculty at the University of Minnesota and Purdue University, Washington University in St. Louis, and now I'm a professor at Harvard. And I teach genetics and population genetics. I wrote Essential Genetics and Genomics because I like to write. I enjoy drafting a paragraph that I'm happy with, and that I think students can understand and learn something from. I also wrote it to be able to reach a much larger number of students than the students who were at my university or sat in my classroom. I like to teach, and I like to think I do it well. And I tried to incorporate the teaching habits that I have learned. I tried to incorporate that into a textbook that students could use and learn from and enjoy. That expression that a good teacher aims to uncover a subject rather than cover it comes from a professor that I had as a graduate student. His name is Bill Stone, and he was studied the genetics of disease resistance. He was an immunologist, and he said he's now in Barcelona and still has a lab in Barcelona. Good for him. And I hadn't thought of it for a long time, but then I began to hear the buzzwords less is more, and I always objected to that, because less isn't more. The truth is less is better in some sense, and so I picked up Bill Stone's statement that the subject, the purpose of a class in genetics is not to cover every detail and define every term and talk about every possible fact. It's to reveal what genetics is all about. So I would rather have students leave my class saying, I understand what genetics is about. I know why these people do what they do. I know how it relates to society as a whole. I know how it relates to me as an individual. I know these are the major directions of research as they're going right now. And I also realize that through the years, I'll forget a lot of the details that I learned, but I'll always remember what this field does and why they do it and why it matters. I've always been bothered by big encyclopedic textbooks that in a one semester course you only go through a third or a half of it. What's the point of even carrying the rest of it around? So the goal was to get rid of that half or two-thirds of an encyclopedic book that people wouldn't use anyway, and just focus on the essential parts of what students need to learn. It's certainly true in genetics that you use it or lose it. Unless you learn how to use the genetic principles in solving problems, you're going to forget them over the summer. So in essential genetics and genomics, I've tried to introduce problems in multiple different ways. One is to get at the perennial problem that students have when they read a section in a chapter. They say, what is it I'm supposed to know from this section? What should I take away from this reading session? And if there's nothing there to suggest what they ought to know, often the response is, I have to memorize all the terms. I have to memorize this example, and I have to memorize that, and I have to memorize that. So in Essential Genetics and Genomics, at key points throughout the chapter, there are problems called stop and think, and they're to get you to stop and think, because they signal what it is you should take home from what you've just read. So do the stop and think problems, because they're very useful. And then at the end of the chapter, there are problems for discussion that are problems which if you saw them on an exam, you would write a little essay, or problems that are worked in exquisite detail to show you exactly how to reason your way through a genetics problem. And then there are a whole set of problems that start with relatively easy ones to give students a sense of self-confidence, and then they progress to rather more difficult ones as the chapter and material progresses. And I find that when students are challenged to solve problems with what they've learned, they retain what they've learned much, much longer than if they just memorize stuff. A famous historian once said that a history of a subject is the subject. And in a certain sense, that's true, because what geneticists have done in the past defines what they're, to a large extent, what they think about now, what are regarded as important problems now. But I think there are other reasons for studying the history of genetics, and that is, in the broader context of the history of science and how science really works. And the points I try to make in my classroom is that virtually every important discovery made in genetics, at the time it was made, was either completely misinterpreted, or its importance wasn't really realized. And it wasn't until later work that led to the correct interpretation of what was going on, or revealed how important that discovery really was. So the first lesson is that you don't always immediately understand the significance of what it is you've found. The second lesson is that basic science sets the stage for what later proved to be very important technological advances, but that can take a very long time. For example, today everybody's talking about CRISPR-Cas9 and how you can edit genes and create new kinds of organisms and so forth and so on, and use this to correct genetic diseases in some cases and so forth. CRISPR-Cas9 of 2018 grew out of research into the genetics of bacteria that started in the 1940s. And the original, and the development of DNA sequencing technology that in the 1980s led to the discovery of weird sequences in bacterial genomes that nobody knows what they did. And it took about 20 years to figure out what they did and how they worked. And then the knowledge was in place to use that technology. Learning is a two-way process, and unless students are engaged, they can't learn. And so part of the challenge is to capitalize on students' interest in society and in themselves and in what's going on around them to get them engaged in genetic issues in the first place. And as I frequently say, the news is full of things that are related to genetics. So the motivation is there. You just have to point it out how it's relevant. Observation is key, because you don't learn something out of nothing. so that you have to bring together the key observations that led up to understanding some principle. Then you reveal the principle that has grown out of those key experiments. And then you use the principle. You have to use the principle in solving problems or in uncovering still other principles that are related to that to fully understand one area of genetics and how it fits into other parts of the field. When a student is struggling in genetics, it's often very, very difficult to know whether it's the genetics itself that they're struggling with, or whether there's something in their background that's missing, or it's not strong enough, or they need some kind of review. And sometimes it's as simple as they forgot how to divide one fraction by another fraction, or they forgot how to deal with exponents, factors of two, or they forgot something about scientific notation, or they forgot something about scales, that a kilometer is bigger than a micrometer. And the readiness assessment helps to disentangle whether it's a problem with the genetics or whether it's a problem with the background. And it's very, very useful for students to go through the readiness assessment just as a refresher on elementary probability things that you probably first got introduced to in middle school, and exponents and things of that sort, so that you've refreshed your memory and you've refreshed your background and you're ready to go. That they understand genetics, they understand the motivation for studying genetics, they understand what genetics grew out of, they understand how genetics relates to society, how it relates to their own health, and the major threads of modern genetic research, the way the field is headed. I want them to understand there are ethical and social issues that impinge on genetics, and that as citizens, they're now equipped to make reasonable judgments on those kinds of issues.